नमस्ते, अ वेरी वॉर्म वेलकम टू VTU ई शिक्षण प्रोग्राम। आई डॉक्टर दाक्षायणी आर पाटिल, असोसिएट प्रोफेसर एट BMS कॉलेज ऑफ आर्किटेक्चर बैंगलोर, वेलकम यू ऑल वंस अगेन ऑन दिस ई लर्निंग प्लेटफॉर्म फॉर द सब्जेक्ट बिल्डिंग सर्विसेज 3 18 ARC 63। So we are presenting this specific program under the VTU e-learning center for the benefit of all students. So building services 3, I am handling modules 1 and 2, and these are the e-lecture sessions. The syllabus for the module 2, which we are currently underway, overview of the references listed in the syllabus. So module 2, we are today on lecture number 8, and we are proceeding with air conditioning systems, the various types of air conditioning systems. We have started off with central air conditioning system. In the past 7 lectures, we have seen an introduction to air conditioning systems, understood the various unitary types of air conditioning systems. 5 types we have seen: window AC, split AC, package AC, rooftop systems, and VRF systems. So continuing with our understanding of central air conditioning system, the learning objectives of today's lecture would be dual duct systems. Last class, to remind, we have completed multi-zone central AC systems. So today we will see dual duct systems, VAV systems, variable air volume systems, all water systems, air water systems. In the past 2 lectures, we have covered all air systems so far. Then we will get into the section of typical central air conditioning systems, and under that 2 types or classifications: direct or DX central system and chilled water AC system. So this would be the content of understanding or course objectives for the today's lecture. Now directly beginning with the dual duct system. The system will basically have 2 separate ducts, one for the hot and one for the cold. So hot main duct and cold main duct running from heating and cooling coils in the air handling unit. Air handling unit is that particular setup which houses the evaporator coil, the filters, and the processing of air to the plant room or the condenser and the compressor for changing or the movement of the refrigerant, enabling the entire process of air conditioning. Now let us take a look at the schematics of a dual duct system. So we have the filter. Now to the left side of the diagram where my cursor is, we can see 2 branches: the return air. Return air R is the used air from the room which has to be conditioned. So return air is going to enter the system, and we are going to add outdoor air or fresh outdoor air which is going to mix with the return air. These 2, the R plus O, will become mixed, and M, quantity of air, is going to enter the filter via the return grills, filter, and then the fan, which is going to create the suction power for the mixed air to enter for further processing. Now if we were to cool the air, the objective of the AC was to cool the air, the mixed air will enter through the damper and cooling coil, that is at the bottom. If we have the objective of heating the air during winters, it passes through the heating coil as per the modulation of the system. Then cooling coils will further lead to the cold ducts C. Heating coil will lead to the hot duct H. So these two will move ahead, and there are mixing boxes of various numbers as per the requirement, and then they move ahead to the other zones. So mixing boxes will confine to zone 1, zone 2 or so. Say zone 1 has X, Y, Z parameters of temperature, humidity and air velocity, and zone 2 has A, B, C requirements. So it is going to take care of that and move to the respective zones for further dissemination to the terminal AC units. So that is how it happens, and then the cycle completes. It comes back to return air R to enter for next round of conditioning. So dual duct system, as clearly mentioned, will have two branches, either for the heating or for the cooling. So there is a cold duct and there is a hot duct, and mixing boxes which lead to the different zones in the system. Now these mixing boxes which we spoke about, which are leading to each zone, they are strategically provided and placed under each zone. Right? So mixing boxes are provided in each zone, which will proceed from the boxes to the respective zones as per the required parameters of air. Now the dampers, the small openings, controlled openings, small gates we may call them, in the box will respond to a room thermostat to mix proper proportions of hot and cold air. So the damper is going to control the quantity of air, and when mixed, how much of hot and cold air to mix to get the required thermostat parameters. Now this will aid, or this will give a good amount of flexibility in controlling the different zones as per the required thermostat settings. Now owing to all these kind of equipments or components that are needed, the installation costs are high or substantial. The fan horsepower requirement is high because large volumes of air is moved at high pressure. So the fan has to undertake the movement of air volumes which are quite large and substantial, because it's a central air conditioning system. So as it is processing larger volumes of air, the fan horsepower expected also to cater to such high volumes, and hence we require a high power for the fans and motors to move the large volume of air at the expected high pressure. Now both multi-zone and dual duct, the multi-zone systems that we saw in the previous lecture and the dual duct here, are inherently energy wasteful, since during part load cooling for a zone, overcooled air is reheated by mixing with warm air again. So when the overcooled air is again mixed with warm air, what happens is, when the system is not running at full load requirement, or there is only partial load running at a given time, but still the process involves overcooled air getting reheated because it is getting mixed with the warm air. Hence, it is tending towards being energy demanding or wasteful. Variable air volume VAV systems Last time, if you remember, we have done a constant air volume system where the air volume supplied to each zone was constant or at a similar parametric setups. But now we will look at variable air volume. So that's what we have discussed, the constant air volume systems so far. Now, variable air volume systems vary the air quantity rather than the temperature to each zone in order to maintain the appropriate room temperature. So, how do they modulate the air movement? By not impacting the temperature of the air, but by maintaining the air volume or the quantity that is provided to each zone in accordance with the temperature that is expected in that particular zone. So air quantity or air volume is used as a tool rather than the air temperature changes happening. A single main duct is run from the air handling unit. So there is a primary main duct which runs from the air handling unit, and it branches ahead to run to the tertiary VAV boxes or the control boxes, and from there it heads to each zone. So each zone is a single space or a set of rooms or spaces which have similar requirements of cooling load, and they are maintained at the same air property parameters. So from the main duct, the branches come out, they reach the VAV boxes where the calibration for the temperature, pressure, humidity has happened, and further it goes to each zone. So that is the mode of operation. So let us see that in a schematic way. You have R. R is the return air. Then we are mixing the outside air O. It gets mixed to get M quantum of air. It runs through the air handling unit. Now air handling unit comprises of the filter, air filters to clean the air, cooling coils or heating coils to reduce the temperature of the hot air, the fan to create the suction for the M to enter the system. Alright, so far I hope it's clear. Then the cooled air is let into through the main duct, the main line on top, and then branches out to the VAV units, which has dampers again. So the right amount of air is now sent to different zones, for example Z1, Z2, Z3, three zones. It could be multiple also, it could branch on top as well. So the simple movement is return air, that is used air from the rooms, various rooms of zone 1, entering through the return air duct, getting mixed with the outside air, that is modulated, the quantum is calibrated, they mix to form M. When you mix the return air with the outside air, it is going to dilute the impurities, right? That's intent. Then M comes in, it runs through the filters, gets cleaned, the fan behind the cooling coil creates the suction, it moves through the coil, and then main branch is seen here. Then from the main branch, it goes on to the sub branches and enters the VAV units, which have the dampers to control how much quantity of air. Because if you remember, what did we see here? VAV varies the air quantity rather than the temperature. So the quantity of air is manipulated by the dampers in the VAV units. And the right amount of air reaches Z1, Z2, Z3 or Z1, Z2, Z3 as you call it to different zones in the building. This is how a variable volume system is going to function essentially. And the components of various items are of the cycle are got and assembled on site. Now there is another circuit, the compressor condenser, which are away from the air handling unit. They are connected to the air handling unit on the other side. Now let us move on to air water systems, sorry, all water systems. So far we have seen all air systems. We were using only air as a fluid media to enable the processes. Now we are heading towards all water systems. Now what is the main principle behind all water system? It distributes hot, either hot water or chilled water from the central AC plant to each of the spaces in the building on each floor. So water system, so the water used either hot water or chilled water, and this is going to initiate from the central plant and move to each of the spaces. There is no involvement of air in all water system. We do not use air, and that's why they are also called as hydronic systems, either all water or hydronic systems. Hydronic terminal units are called as fan coil units. By the word terminal unit, we mean the unit that is going to end in the circuit at individual spaces or rooms in the building. The terminal unit which is going to supply the cool conditioned air into the space. So hydronic terminal units, that's the technical word for a all water system, could be fan coil unit, for example, fan coil units which in which they are all embedded as a single unit and placed in the room. For commercial uses, it takes up less space and is less expensive. So all water systems are a hit with large scale commercial buildings owing to the prospects that they take up less space and they consume less investment, or they are less expensive. Now water has, because we are using water, water is the media by which we are enabling the processes. Water has much higher specific heat and density than air, right? That's an integral property of the matter or the material. The water is denser. Hence, owing to this, less volume of water needs to be circulated for the same amount of heat transfer if air was involved. So compared to what air system would do, water volume required is much less even for targeting the same amount of required heat transfer. Hence, how does this help us in reducing the cross-section of the pipes? Cross-section of the pipes become smaller, sleeker, less bulkier, less expensive. Hence, they are helpful in space restraint projects. So when you have projects that come with their own space related restraints or minimal space available, or a requirement of reducing the amount of ducting and these kind of servicing auxiliary items, it becomes helpful to adopt all water systems. Let us summarize or understand the advantages of all water systems. Okay. Disadvantages. Let us look at the disadvantages. Multiplicity of fan coil units, the terminal units. When you have many of these across the building spaces or rooms, it invariably suggests that a great deal of maintenance works is involved, isn't it? So you have multiple fan coil units dispersed across the different rooms or spaces. It increases the maintenance work and costs as well. Control of ventilation air quantities is not precise with small fans. So controlling the air quantity towards ventilation with respect to small fans is not a precision calibration. Control of humidity is also seemingly limited. Now moving on, this is the last classification with respect to the medium used, air-water systems. So it distributes both hot and chilled water and conditioned air from a central system to individual rooms. It uses the best properties or characteristics of all air and all water systems. So it is going to adopt the essential advantages of all air and all water systems in a meaningful manner. Now the terminal units in each of the room, we call it as the fan coil units, or they could be the induction units. So again, each room is going to house the terminal unit, which could be a fan coil unit or a induction unit. Most of the energy is carried in the water. So you have air and water circulating or navigating through the pipes. We are taking the advantages of both here, but essentially water has the capacity to carry more energy, since and hence it does most of the work in the energy system. So far we have now understood basics of central AC in terms of zoning, single zone, multiple zone, and the various variable air volume or constant air volume which we can adopt. Then we have seen all water system, all air system, air water system. So now we will proceed in understanding the design of a typical central air conditioning system. So what are the components? Now so far we have already done a few parts of this, like air handling unit, etc. Now we will precisely look at the details. Now two types of central air conditioning systems are available. One is the direct expansion system or the DX system. Second is the chilled water system. Two typologies available. Okay. Now we will start with the DX system or the direct system. Firstly, what I'm going to show you is a cross section of a typical system, air conditioning system. So what do we see here? To the left side we have the air conditioned room, that is the room that is going to be conditioned for the required air comfort levels. Then what do you see? Component number two, AHU room, that is air handling unit. Then you have the plant room. Alright, now what does the plant room? Will now come from the right side. Now in the plant room, you are seeing there is a compressor, there is a condenser. The short form written there, but that is the compressor. and this is the condenser. Then the condenser is water cooled. Condensers can be of two type, water cooled or air cooled. Now this condenser is water cooled. Hence you can see the pipe running onto the terrace of that plant room, and there is a cooling tower. Okay. All right. Then what else does the plant room have? It has a fresh air duct with damper on the wall that is between the plant room and the AHU room. Okay, there is a fresh air duct with damper. Now AHU room, the next one that you see. Okay, what do you have in the AHU room? You have the evaporator coil or the cooling coil. You have the air filters. We have the fan section, which is going to create the suction power to take in the used air into the system. Then you have the return air duct or passage, and then the supply air duct into the conditioned room. Then when you come to the conditioned room to the left side, what do you observe? There is RA diffuser, that is return air diffuser, SA diffuser, that is a supply air diffuser. So by now I think we are acquainted. Return air arrow is going towards the grills or the diffuser. It means the used air from the room is getting into the plenum space. This space where my arrow is called as the plenum space. Plenum space is the space between the false ceiling and the ceiling slab. Now it is a space where the duct of the AC is moving. Now return air diffuser or grill, the hot air gets sucked into. Now what is creating that suction power? It is the fan section that you see in the AHU room. Do you see that? Is it clear? So this fan section is going to create the suction power for the return air to enter into the diffuser. Okay. Now that air in the plenum space again is going to enter through the return air duct and enter the AHU room. Now there is one more in the plenum space, there is supply air duct. And the supply air duct is going to give the clean, cool, dehumidified air into the space via the supply air diffuser. So you have the arrows coming into the space, whereas for the return air diffusers, the arrows are going into the diffuser. So, and AHU room and plant room are the ones which are doing all the mechanical work of conditioning the air with the basis of the refrigeration cycle. So we have the evaporator here, compressor, condenser, all are connected by the liquid line, the suction line. There is a thermostatic expansion valve, TEV, which controls the amount and quantity of refrigerant that flows into the evaporator coil, by which the pressure and temperature drop, pressure drops, and then it enters here. Now compressor condenser are doing their job in this plant room. Then you have the condenser water pump. You need to cool the condenser because it's really getting to be really hot there. The refrigerant is going to boil. So you have dampers for fresh air at every point. So this is a typical spatial arrangement of a central air conditioning DX system. The point to note in this section is the air handling unit is always connected to the a room to be conditioned. That's very essential. And a dedicated cooling tower is required. The water tank for normal usage in the building will not suffice for the condenser water requirements. It has to be a dedicated water tank for the plant room. Hence, we have seen these three spaces: the space to be conditioned, air handling unit, AHU room, which is continuous to the contiguous to the AC space, and it houses the evaporator, expansion valve, filters, fan, and the refrigerant pipings. So these many are accommodated in the AHU room, air conditioning plant room, which can be either attached to the AHU in this manner, or it could be detached, it could be further away also. But we have to see that if it is too further away, the ducting distances increase. Once the duct distance increases, there it is going to have a pressure drop. Pressure drop means more energy loss or more energy expended to achieve the required heating or cooling. So AC plant room houses the compressor, condenser, and the fresh air duct with the damper. So these are the three main components and the subcomponents in that. Now, interestingly, the supply and return air ducts, which are running in the plenum space or in the false ceiling space, have to be insulated. Why? Because they are passing through non-conditioned space. Now, for example, the supply air duct is going to carry the air at say 17 degrees Celsius which has to be supplied to the space. But when it passes through the non-air conditioned plenum space, it is running through a normal space where the temperature of the air surrounding, which is housing that return air, would be warmer, and this 17 degree may increase by the time it reaches the actual space where it is intended to go. So hence, we have to insulate these return and supply air ducts for the better efficiency, and separate it so as to as they pass through the non-conditioned space. We meant by this space, that one. Now let us see a typical central AC chilled water system. What happens here? Spatial requirements are the same. Now you see a series of G+3 floors of air conditioned space, the space that is required to be cooled. Then AHU room. AHU room is supposed to be on all the floors, one above the in all the floors, ideally one over the other. So AHU room with its components are seen there, whereas plant room is a single provision, either attached to the AHU at the ground floor, or it could be detached also. Various factors impact the location, ideal location of the plant room. So what do we have? We are seeing that there is an influx of little fresh air for the AHU at every floor, fresh air duct with dampers. Okay, we have chilled water cooling coil, plant room, compressor, condenser, chiller, cooling tower, then above expansion tank, and in the plant room you have the chilled water pump, connection for filling up the system, thermostatic expansion valve TEV, condenser water pump. Alright, so it is essential that you draw a typical section which is proportionate in scale, label, draw the all the components, label them, show the ducts, show all the various specific components, show the diffusers, return air route, and the supply air thrown out. Going to the next part. Now, AC plant rooms are normally composed of heavy duty machinery and ducts of various scales, color coded, labeled for easy maintenance. So, a lot of things hanging from the ceiling. So, structural design is very essential, compliance with the structural drawings and understanding the various structural components, beams, slabs, the weight bearing capacity, etc. Now, DX system or the direct system, the compressor and condenser are housed in the plant room, which is adjacent to the AHU room, and the AHU will have the evaporator and the thermal expansion valve TEV or the throttling device, refrigerant control valve, so many variations to the name. Suction and liquid lines connect the condensing unit to the evaporator coil. Suction and liquid lines connect the condensing unit to the evaporator coil. The compressor is normally of open hermetic type or semi-hermetic type. You can do a reading on that ahead. In case if water cooled condenser is there, we definitely have to provide a water tank dedicated for the purpose. The normal day water usage tank is not going to be provided or used for this particular reason, but we need to have a dedicated water tank for the water cooled condenser with a steady flow. So DX system, what happens is the air from the space to be air conditioned is circulated over the cooling coil, that is the evaporator. So in the evaporator, in which the low pressure refrigerant liquid is boiling, latent heat of vaporization for the liquid refrigerant is taken from the air being circulated over the coil. Hence, it is known as direct expansion or DX system. So, because the process of the latent heat of vaporization that is required for the liquid refrigerant is directly taken from the air that is going to circulate around the evaporator. Hence, it is called as direct expansion or DX system. Now, let us take a look at the chilled water central air conditioning system. Which is also called as indirect system. Chilled water or the brine from the refrigeration plant is circulated through the cooling coil, which is located in the air handling unit to cool or dehumidify the room air. Is it clear? So in direct system, what happened? There was a direct transfer from the refrigerant or to the air around the evaporator. But here we have a medium in between the two, that is a chilled water. Okay, the chilled water or brine from the refrigeration plant is circulated through the cooling coil located in the AHU to cool and dehumidify the room air. Hence, it is called as chilled water or brine system also. So both are synonymously used, central chilled water AC system or brine system. Now the compressor along with the drive motor and the water cooled condenser along with the evaporator, all these are in a structural steel framework which is called as the chiller package. Now you might have come across this word, this is a chiller plant, chiller package, anywhere whatsoever. So what does it mean? This chiller package is a structural framework in which the compressor is embedded along with the condenser and the evaporator. So chiller package, you can always sometimes call chiller plant. Hence, since all are embedded together, it is always a compact equipment or a compact provision. The refrigerant piping, in which the refrigeration is flowing, the expansion valve or the throttling device, the liquid line also are compact. The chiller and the evaporator coils in AHU are connected by chilled water pipes to a chilled water pump. Now this is a schematic view section of a typical chilled water system. So we have the boiler and the chiller. It could be on the basement. In the basement, there is a pump provision for the chilled water, hot water, and the cooling tower. Energy management system, in the sense to configure the to assess and monitor and modulate the energy consumption by these different mechanical services that are happening in the HVAC department in this building. Then we have the air handler, could be the air handling unit, outside air intake, the various ducts that are seen, and ultimately the end has the terminal unit. Terminal unit is the cassette type AC or a floor mounted console model or the wall hung, and the diffuser is the point in this cassette AC or wall hung AC through which return air is entering the space, return air is going away from the space, and supply air is entering into the space. Supply air is the cooled, cleaned, dehumidified air. Then we also have provision for a cooling tower dedicated to undertake the condenser cooling mechanism. So it's a water cooled condenser. Very well represented. Now we'll take the case of hotels. What are the points that we have to essentially remember when we are doing the hotel HVAC system? We need independent temperature control. There is low sensible heat, because if you consider a guest room in a hotel, only one side may be projected towards the outside. The other three are already enclosed with air conditioned area, right? So that's the thing. So prevention, and another important aspect is prevention of noise from the adjoining rooms. It's not like that we eavesdropping on the next visitor in the next room, or you may not even require eavesdropping, it's just easily audible. So noise is not a very accepted level in a hotel guest room. Transmission of odors between rooms to be avoided, definitely. So guest rooms will come with fan coil units are advisable. So each one of them can calibrate their own parameters for the heating, cooling, etc. Common distribution is not applied. A solenoid operated three-way or two-way valve on the chilled water inlet is to be provided. It is controlled, or the units, terminal units, are controlled by room thermostat. Public areas include spaces like lobby, reception, bars, shopping, banquet, etc. and which can be managed by air handling unit. So all these lobby, reception, bars, shopping, etc. can be operated or independently monitored, manipulated by the air handling unit or the fan coil units. There is a large diversity factor noticed in case of a hotel. I'm sure you also agree on that. And the engineer and the architect have to consider this, reach to a consensus in the design output of the HVAC. Cooling tower installation. So this is a cooling tower. The cooling tower shall be mounted on a set of 4 or 6 numbers of reinforced cement concrete pillars. Okay, if you see to the right side, you may see 4 or more here, which will act as a structural foundation. The height should not less than 1000 mm and should be as per the space required to install a pot strainer below the water level in cooling tower sump, drain pipe and valve for complete drainage of the sump. It should permit the maintenance of the slab upon which the structural foundation is installed. So this kind, giving these kind of buffer spaces for the maintenance personnel to carry out various works which are quite happening frequently on a regular basis. So provision of such maintenance around the unit is very crucial, and proper buffers before you plan anything in the close vicinity has to be taken care of. You may call it as the setback also. So as per NBC, the cooling tower should be located at a well ventilated place. And what more we can look for other than our open air terraces. And these are always designed, planned and placed in consultation with the structural engineer and the structural drawings. The dynamic structural loading has to be considered, the water weight and the various other units that are happening. There is movement of all these fluids rapidly. Dynamic load to transfer should transfer directly to the building structural column, for which necessary mild steel I sections may have to be provided. Now the building is will be on a grid, basically structural grid. And there are structural RCC columns. So it is essential that the dynamic load of the cooling tower is transferred to these columns in the structural grid. And for this to happen, it is essential that mild steel I sections be used or adopted to enable this transfer of dynamic load through the structural column to the foundation. Epoxy coating is required for the I sections. These materials or items have to be protected well against any exposure to moisture leading to corrosion, etc. So epoxy coating is required for the I sections. Vibration isolation pads are to be provided between the tower and the I sections in order to avoid the transfer of vibration. Quite substantial vibration happening here, and we should avoid transfer of this vibration to the building structure. So care has to be borne in this matter. And vibration isolation pads are frequently used wherever we encounter any equipment undergoing these kind of activities or vibration, which may get transferred to the building and weakening the structural support for all we know. Sufficient space should be given around the cooling tower support structure for efficient operation of the cooling tower. So operation is one thing, maintenance is another thing. So seeing that there is enough setback around the cooling tower support structure is very essential. When the cooling tower is installed at ground level, contiguous to the utility services block, care has to be exercised to prevent persons coming in close proximity to the cooling tower. The cooling tower, as per norms, is not a zone where a common man or anybody can just jaywalk there or utilize it for any purpose. So avoiding this is to avoid danger to the people who are approaching the area. So to avoid exposure to the Legionella bacteria, which can hibernate in the cooling tower some, if not regularly conducted bleed off and chemical treatment of the condenser water. So unless the maintenance is done well, taking care of the bleed off and chemical treatment of the condenser water, it may lead to hosting the Legionella bacteria, which is bad for a person's health, and exposure to this can be avoided by putting proper signages or creating those subtle barriers which discourage people from going to the near vicinity of the cooling tower. Now, to just quick summary on what we have seen: central HVAC system, central air conditioning systems. We have all air systems, in which we definitely saw single zone, multi zone, then terminal reheat component, dual duct component, variable air volume, fan coil unit, induction unit, and fan coil units for the all water system. So air water system will adopt either fan coil or induction coil, like we saw in the previous section. All water systems will use fan coil units. Then the rest all is same. So water source heat pumps are a general stretch out from the central AC along with the heating and cooling panels. So this is how a central AC is going to be working. I hope it was clear. This is a link for understanding the working and features of an air handling unit. So let us conclude this very important session on central air conditioning with this exercise. It's an important exercise which will definitely value add. Undertake an online case study of a HVAC network system for a commercial project designed by any eminent architect or architectural firm in India. A quick glance through some very interesting projects which have adopted innovative HVAC network systems. Design a suitable central AC system for any of your architectural design studio project and justify the same. So take one of your design studio projects. You could as well take the current semester's design project and try to design HVAC layout for the same. So let us see if you adopt unitary or you use a combination of both, or you go in for central AC, depends on you. But kindly justify why you are using that particular air conditioning system in your design. What made you choose this? What were the pros and cons, or what opportunities did you see as an architect in creating a good design per se? All right. So we end the lecture number 8 here with, that closes the central air conditioning system. So basically we have seen all the types of AC systems now. In the lecture number 9 ahead, we are going to witness the air distribution system, ADS, and details of duct design in the buildings. That's it from my end for this current section number 9. See you ahead with the next section in the module 2. Until then, take care and bye.